taking us to the zoo tomorrow. Zoo tomorrow, zoo tomorrow. Daddy's taking us to the zoo tomorrow. We can stay all day. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. How about you, you, you? You can come too, too, too. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. See the elephant with the long trunk swinging, the great big ears and the long trunk swinging, sniffing up peanuts with the long trunk swinging. We can stay all day. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. How about you, you, you? You can come too, too, too. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. See all the monkeys scritch, scritch, scratching, jumping all around and scritch, scritch, scratching, hanging by their long tail, scritch, scritch, scratching. We can stay all day. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. How about you, you, you? You can come too, too, too. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. Big black bear, hoof, 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 hoofing. Coat's too heavy, he's hoof, 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 hoofing. Don't get too near the hoof, 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 hoofing, or you won't stay all day. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. How about you, you, you? You can come too, too, too. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. Seals in the pool, honk, honk, honking. Catching fish and honk, honk, honking. Little seals are ah, ah, honking. And we can stay all day. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. How about you, you, you? You can come too, too, too. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. Well, we stayed all day. We're getting sleepy. Sitting in the car, getting sleep, sleep, sleepy. Home already, and we're sleep, sleep, sleepy. We have stayed all day. We've been to the zoo, zoo, zoo. So have you, you, you. You came to, too, too. We've been. Mama's taking us to the zoo tomorrow, zoo tomorrow, zoo tomorrow. Mama's taking us to the zoo tomorrow. We can stay all day. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo. How about you, you, you? You can come too, too, too. We're going to the zoo, zoo, zoo.
My mind, I'd tell a tale to all. The seahorse is sleeping. The hammerhead's not feeling well.
The catfish is yawning. It's lights out time. Down at the sea hotel.
Good night.
Stretches all eight of his arms down at the sea hotel.
Good night,
good night.
Sleep tight,
sleep tight.
Down at the sea hotel.
Good night,
good night.
Sleep tight,
sleep tight. Good night,
good night.
Sleep tight,
sleep tight.
Down at the sea hotel. Good night,
good night.
Sleep tight.
Good evening. We're gonna do that again. Good evening. Welcome to the Freight and Salvage. I'm Sri Livy. I'm tonight's event manager. And I tell you, the freight just keeps getting better and better. Our newly expanded education department has created a series of pre-show talks to enhance our show experience and get an intimate glimpse into the creative process of our performers. So this is the second in this series. And tonight we have Bay Area music journalist, Yoshi Kato, and our headliner for the last two nights, Vienna Teng.
Hello all, thanks for coming early. I saw quite an enthusiastic line out there, so I'm happy to speak with Vienna. Full disclosure, my mother taught her two siblings in second grade.
And it's a small world, it's really fun. We're having fun reminiscing.
That's right. And one thing I was curious, it's very basic, but I don't know where you are these days. I've heard Detroit, Denver, D.C., and I was wondering if you could tell us just geographically where you're located
these
days.
I am anywhere with a D name, apparently. Yes. Yeah. No, that's all correct. I just moved to Washington, D.C. a couple months ago.
Okay.
And before that, I was in Colorado. My husband works at a place called the Rocky Mountain Institute, and so they were headquartered in Boulder, so we were there for a few years. And then he and I met in Detroit and Ann Arbor, Michigan. Yeah.
And I know you have some solo shows towards the end of the year, concluding with these, is that right? And I'm wondering how much you get to play these days with your other work.
Not a lot. So someone was asking me recently like how I balance different things in my life because I have long-term ADD and I like doing lots of different things. And the main answer I give is that there's always like a primary thing at any given time. So these days I play maybe like between 4 to 10 shows a year, which is not a lot. And haven't spent a lot of time writing new material or thinking about kind of continuing my creative journey as a musician, but more just kind of revisiting and coming and spending time in that, you know, in that home that I call music, I guess you could say.
And I imagine the two pursuits sort of nurture each other?
They do. I feel like, not in like a super direct way, but I feel like what I've realized is that my relationship with music is sometimes best as an escape or a procrastination technique. So I really like it when I get to escape to music or kind of step on stage and realize like, oh, I don't get to do this very often. This is a really amazing privilege that I get to, you know, perform and share time with people in this way. So the gratitude is definitely much more kind of intense when it's something that I don't do as often.
And can you tell us a little bit about the work?
Oh, yeah. So I currently work for a nonprofit, which is founded by a for-profit company. So it's called McKinsey.org, which is the nonprofit founded by McKinsey & Company. And at the moment, I'm part of a team that focuses on sustainability issues. So one of our programs is called Rethinking Recycling. And we work with communities in Latin America and in Southeast Asia trying to figure out how do you actually build recycling systems for the 21st century when we really have to contend with climate change and with reuse of materials and kind of like, you know, the limited resources of the planet, as well as what are the needs of the people right now, what are the needs of the community right now, and how do you kind of make it all work economically, socially, environmentally. So that's kind of the puzzle that we work on putting together.
And does that tie into your grad school work in Michigan?
It does, yeah. Okay. So I studied sustainable enterprise at the University of Michigan. So the way I joke about it is that I got an MBA and a master's in environmental studies, which meant that I was a tree hugger and a capitalist pig at the same time, which made me very confused at different points. But it was nice actually to see that by the time I got there, they were not such different worlds, that most of the MBA students were thinking about things from a sustainability perspective in terms of what greater purpose were they going to serve. And the environmental students were thinking much more of, you know, kind of how do we bring all the different players into this, including industry, including government, including, you know, the people who used to be the enemy, you could say, and kind of all be part of the same solution.
And I remember reading online the idea that it's public, private, and social partnerships, and I'm wondering how those three break down.
Oh, you mean in terms of the work?
Work, or? Yes.
Oh, yeah. So the idea is, with McKinsey.org, we really try to cast a broad net in terms of who we work with. And so we really want to make sure that, you know, government has its role to play, and that's kind of the public partnership piece. So, for example, our work in Indonesia, we're engaging all these different ministries in the Indonesian government, as well as kind of local leadership and leadership, you know, kind of at the provincial level. Same thing in Argentina. And then with social partnerships, making sure that, you know, the nonprofits and the grassroots organizations and the social mission driven organizations are part of it too. And of course the private sector, like the, you know, the big companies that produce a lot of the packaging that currently ends up in the ocean or currently ends up you know, on the streets, are also, you know, very much part of thinking through how it's all gonna work and playing their part.
One thing I've always appreciated about your music, particularly in a live setting, is how much collaboration there is. We'll see that and hear that tonight. And I'm wondering if you see any parallels with the sort of partnerships you do with that work and your music.
Oh, it's really interesting. I hadn't thought about that. and I'm flattered that you find my music highly collaborative, because I think of it as like my collaborators put up with me. Because I am sort of a solitary person by nature when it comes to music. But I have found that one of the things that I think really helped was when someone told me, like, oh, of course, not every collaboration works. It's like dating. Mm. And that was kind of a relief to me, because I just felt like I was going on all these dates that weren't really clicking and writing some mediocre songs that I wasn't that excited about, and sort of had decided, like, maybe I'm not good at co-writing, maybe I'm not good at collaborating. And to be told that, like, no, it's about finding the right match. and eventually finding collaborators like Alex Wong and the producers I've gotten to make albums with. And it's really about getting to a place where you can really trust both someone's instincts and where they're coming from and the fact that they are valuing what you're bringing to the table. I think that's kind of the parallel in terms of collaborating for kind of bigger causes and social impact is, it does actually come down to the which partners do you want to work with and do you feel like you can trust one another? Do you feel like you can have the right conversations and push each other in the right way? And sometimes there are partnerships that look right on paper but don't actually work in reality, and then it's a matter of like figuring out like who are the real allies that you want to have that are going to keep you honest and kind of, you know, bring their own strengths and kind of make a bigger things greater than the sum of its parts.
And we were talking backstage how a friend of mine, Toddy Noe, who's a great writer down in San Jose, had interviewed you fairly early in your career, I think, and you were telling him about your stage name or your artistic name and how that when you saw it on a marquee, you could separate that from yourself. And it occurred to me that that's sort of what we're all experiencing in the social media age, being a username or
right.
what have you. And I'm wondering how that experience is now, having a professional name maybe and then an artistic name.
Yeah. I think when I started out, it was really useful for me to sort of dissociate myself from this person, this musician that I wanted to be, because it was such a break from kind of the path in life that maybe I expected and that most people expected, because I, you know, grew up in Silicon Valley, went to, you know, Stanford University, studied computer science, and then kind of, you could say, threw it all away to go, you know, drive around in a compact rental car with my CDs in the back and play for, you know, play in little coffee houses around the country. So I think in the beginning it was really useful for me to say, like, well, this is sort of almost someone else doing it. It's someone else who really wants to make this happen. It's sort of this, like, alternate persona. But I think as it became more and more my real life and the more I kind of became comfortable with it, the more it felt very integrated to who I really am. And by the time I went to graduate school at the University of Michigan, it just felt like everything I brought to the classroom or to the work I was doing was just informed by who I was, you know, on stage and writing songs. And so these days it doesn't feel so separate. But it's an interesting thing you ask about social media and how everybody kind of has that alternate persona these days.
Or can have it, yeah.
And can, yeah. And I do think about that. I don't post a lot these days, but I have noticed that without really meaning to, I also still create a brand, you could say, you know, when I post things online. I want to be not the person who, like, posts things when I'm annoyed. Like, It feels important to me, like, although I could, like, I don't want to be someone who complains about stuff online. Somehow that's important to me, and I'm not sure why. So there are always these kind of decisions of, like, how do I present myself? I think that lots of people are thinking about now, and, like,
right.
How are you going to contribute to the whole soup of voices out there?
I hadn't thought about that. And I was at a Regina Spektor concert just down the street a couple years ago at the Greek Theater, and I was sitting next to this couple. They might have been on a first date, and I remember him saying, "Hey, have you heard of Vienna Teng? I discovered her on Pandora." And the journalist in me wanted to turn to him and say, "Well, I'm glad you didn't ask about her," but I thought better of that. But in reflecting back at that story, it made me realize that you started in a CD era, like you talk about, and kind of are of that last generation to make the switch from CDs to Pandora to the iTunes store to Spotify now and other streaming services. And I'm wondering what it's like to have that perspective of the changes in the industry.
Yeah, I kind of feel like my own personal decisions of when to kind of enter the music industry and when to kind of step away from it to do something else just ended up being a very fortuitous kind of timing, because I came into music around like 2000, 2001, around the time when being on a major label was not the only way to do things. And you could get discovered online on MySpace or mp3.com or whatever it was. And people still bought CDs, and so you could actually, you know, sell CDs and make some, you know, modest income through that. And, you know, touring was still something that wasn't so fiercely competitive, and you could kind of make your inroads that way. And then when I was, just as I was leaving, was when I saw a lot of my peers and a lot of my friends really struggle with this, like, okay, a lot of our streams of income are kind of going away or are dropping, you know, precipitously because of streaming, and what are we going to do about that? And so I've seen them kind of navigate that in really creative ways, but it was also a moment where I'm like, well, my paycheck's coming from somewhere else, so I haven't had to grapple with it in the same way. I guess I overall feel like what I've learned about the music industry is that, you know, no one deserves to have everything stay the same, but also, especially musicians and creators, get what they advocate for and what they fight for. And so I've been trying to pay more attention to groups like Future of Music Coalition and groups like that that are really kind of paying attention to, like, well, how do royalty rates for streaming get set? How do these, you know, rules for, you know, mechanical royalties or whatever else, these things that actually sound very technical but really matter for whether people can make a living doing what they love. And a lot of it has to do with whether enough people raise their voices to say, like, this is important to us, both as creators and as people who are listeners, and say, we want people to have time to make, you know, the art that matters to them.
And I'm a big fan of settings in storytelling, and I also feel like where one performs live concerts is also part of the whole experience. So I wanted to ask you about a few venues, starting with Freight and Salvage. And I was looking through my emails and found one from 2011 where you were performing December 29th and December 30th, and both shows were sold out. So I was wondering if you could first talk just about performing here, which is kind of a mainstay, it seems like, when you come back home.
Yeah. There really aren't very many places like the Freight and Salvage in the world, or in certainly in the U.S. I think there's something, you know, for people who might be listening to this and not able to see the venue, like, it's a really kind of warm and welcoming space. It feels very organic. You know, there's, like, wood paneling, and there are kind of seats in these, like, kind of warm colors. There are these really interesting chandeliers hanging from the roof and from the ceiling, and it just kind of, once you step into it, you feel like, oh, this is a place where people come together to do something that matters. And not in kind of a stuffy, you know, kind of uptight way, but, like, you know, we're all here to kind of focus our energy for a little while. And I feel like being on the stage for, you know, in this kind of place, and it's not, of course, just the physical surroundings, but, like, all the care and attention that happens behind the scenes in programming the calendar and having volunteers kind of help the place run smoothly, having a beautiful piano that they keep in tune and and in good shape, so it's a good, you know, performing companion. All of that makes a huge difference, so that when I step on stage, I kind of feel like, oh, I get to kind of do what I do here. I get to create a moment for people, and everything in the environment kind of has been set up to do that. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yeah, absolutely. And then I also wanted to ask you about playing Bing Concert Hall at your alma mater. I remember hearing that sold out, and it was kind of a last-minute addition, so do you have any recollections of that?
Yeah, I remember, you know what I mostly remember from playing Bing Concert Hall was just this gorgeous, very different sort of space, but kind of like a state-of-the-art, very kind of unusual and gorgeous performance space. I remember standing in the wings waiting to walk on and immediately, like, having this, like, growing intimidation building in my head and really trying to kind of just tamper that down and be like, don't freak out. And kind of walking on stage and just sort of taking it all in terms of the grandeur of the space and the fact that it was full of people. And sometimes, for someone like me, it can kind of kick into this space of, like, who am I? Like, why am I here? So I guess it ended up being, like, a really beautiful and, like, special concert, and it was particularly fun because it's a little bit of an in-the-round kind of venue. And when I asked people to come up on stage with me to perform, they sort of ended up forming a circle around the piano, which was kind of an unusual kind of setting and a really fun way to make music. But I do remember beginning with a sense of intimidation then, and it's something that I have to get over as a performer in particularly beautiful, grand spaces of, like, who the hell am I and why am I here?
And then I think you did Villa Montalvo with Duncan Sheik?
I think so. I've opened for a few people at Villa Montavo in like kind of the outdoor amphitheater.
And that's one of our hometown venues in Saratoga.
Right.
And is there something about playing something that you've kind of grown up with in terms of space?
Yeah, it feels pretty special. I've performed both in the amphitheater opening for bigger artists and in an indoor venue they have called the Carriage House. And it always tickles me to like kind of drive up for loading into the venue because it's where my family would go hiking all the time. So it's like, oh, we're either going to go for a family hike or I'm going to play a show. And there's a real sweetness and a sense of, I guess, yeah, full circle when you like play a hometown gig like that. Yeah.
And the last thing I wanted to ask you, coming in, I was just amazed at the energy of everybody, of all you waiting in line. And it got me thinking about the relationship with your fans, which is now going into its third decade, I would imagine.
Right.
The math is correct. And some might be parents now. And I was wondering if you could talk about that, and especially with technology, how that might have changed as well.
Yeah, well, I have a feeling what it's like, actually, to bring it back to your mom as a second grade teacher. Like, I have a feeling what it's like when, you know, students come back to visit, you know. Because, I have been making music long enough now that people will say, like, oh, I started listening to you in middle school, and now I have my PhD and, you know, got married. And I remember I wrote this one song, Anna Rose, for a kid who my friend in college was babysitting. And I think she was 5 at the time. And I still occasionally get both updates from her family who come to the shows and sometimes from Anna Rose herself, you know, who is now, you know, in her, I think, it must be like late 20s now. So that's always kind of fun. It's like, oh yeah, you were a 5-year-old drawing things, you know, like to songs, and now you're, you know, completely, like, you know, grown person, you know, who's kind of an extension of that, you know, 5-year-old's journey. And so it's pretty amazing. And I especially love the stories when people say, I remember it was like, it could sound like a backhanded compliment, but I didn't take it that way. Someone said, I went through a period where it was really hard to listen to your music because I associated with this time in my life that like things were really intense and then things went really bad and I was what I listened, you know, and you were what I listened to kind of get through that. And once I was out of that space, I didn't really want to kind of go back in there. You were sort of the soundtrack of the hard times. and so that always actually means a lot to kind of realize that you create something and you send it into the world and you have no idea what it's doing out there. And to find that it's been solace for people, that it's changed people's minds or kind of been a little nudge that sent them on the path that they're on. There's no fulfillment quite like that, yeah.
And are you at the point, as sort of a coda to that, where you've had both older musicians that you worked with early on and now you yourself are able to work with the next generation? Are you at that point now?
Oh, good question. Lately, when I play shows, there are often younger people who are kind of my opening act.
Right.
And so recently I've had some, you know, some really talented songwriters and piano players who have, I think the, you know, one of them was 18 and the other one was, you know, in her early 20s. And it's really fun to kind of see, you know, what the younger folks are doing. And I guess I have never really thought of myself as kind of like, you know, part of an older generation. Maybe I should, but I still feel like I'm figuring it out as well. And there's so many visionary, precocious writers, you know, who are much younger than me. And I feel like when we kind of sit backstage and talk, we're sort of more talking as peers.
Right.
You know, they have ideas and things they're exploring that I'm like, oh, that actually sparks something for me too. So it almost still feels like it's one of the beautiful things about music is that it's sort of transgenerational and
right.
You can kind of meet in the same place with it when you're on that same road together.
Excellent. Well, I think we will let you get ready for your set. Thanks so much for taking the time to speak with us, and we'll be anticipating you being back out here on the bandstand.
Thank you, Yoshi.
Tell me why. watch and listen. Can't blame it on the moon no more. No. Can't blame it on the radar weather. Can't blame it on my lucky stars or my mother or my father. While I'm holed up in the bell tower, looking for four walls to bounce off, looking for a donkey I could maybe pin a tail on. Well, I'm taking a staying up late, I'm taking up lonely. Take a couple aspirin and I call my lover in the morning. And I've taken to talking to myself and I don't even get it. Gotta get out of my head, it'll drive me crazy if I let it. Who holds?
Good evening. Good evening.
No.
Good evening.
Excuse me. Here's this one, and I'll pick that one up to see. I don't know what's happening. I don't know what's happening either.
All right. You know what? I'm going to do this again.
Good evening. Welcome to the Freight and Salvage. I'm Sri Devi. I'm tonight's event manager, and I am delighted to welcome you all here tonight. Are you delighted to be here? All right. The Freight and Salvage is a nonprofit community arts organization that first opened doors in 1968, so we've been here 51 years. That's a long time. I think that needs a round of applause. Is there anybody here for the very first time? Please raise your hand. All right, round of applause. Great. Keep your hands up. I want to see who you all are. Oh, quite a number of you. Great. Welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. And are there any friends of the Freight here, our official friends of the Freight? Please raise your hands as well. I want to see you. All right, another round of applause for our friends of the Freight. That's what we call our donors. We have managed to stay here for 51 years because of the generous gifts from our friends of the Freight. If you are interested in becoming an official donor, you can do so right outside this lobby door. To my right, there is a table there to sign up, or if you just want to drop something in the little drop box, little piggy bank thing, you can do that as well. And for the next 2 days, we have something special going on. Want to know what it is? We have a donor who is offering a matching grant, so or matching donations. So whatever you donate between now, right now, and the 31st, that's tomorrow, will be doubled. And that includes any change that you drop in that piggy bank. Ooh. You may also donate on state, or sorry, donate online. You may donate online at thefreight.org/donate. Sorry, I'm multitasking here. Okay, we have the secret communication. You can also mail in a donation. So long as we get it before January 10th, it will still be doubled. And also outside on the right side of this door, there is a table there, and you'll find pamphlets and envelopes there. You could also go to the box office, do all of that. Okay, and so our operations manager is holding up a bucket. Please hold up that bucket so everyone can see. Ooh, round of applause for Bob. If you have not already done so, Vienna is taking song requests. So right outside the door, straight ahead, there are little slips of paper. Write your song request and put it in that bucket, and that will be out there through the end of intermission. So you got to get it in before the end of intermission, so you have all of intermission to do it. All right, so everyone knows that we have great shows scheduled almost every night of the week, but what a lot of people don't know is that we also offer classes, and those will be starting shortly. So if you are looking to join a chorus, learn live sound, harmonize on some bluegrass tunes, find your voice through songwriting, get busy on the bass, or anything else, check out our calendar. You can get a hard copy calendar here or also online, thefreight.org. So those classes will be starting up soon. All right, so ready to get ready for tonight's show? Okay, first thing, cell phones. Please put your cell phones on silent. Please silence your cell phones, please. Photo policy tonight is that you may take photos throughout the performance. However, do not use the flash. So non-flash photos are allowed tonight. What kind of photos? All right, no video, no audio. We have a couple of designated people, but other than them, nobody else. All right, in the unlikely case of an emergency, the emergency exits are the doors you came through as well as on the sides. If you do need to step out for any other reason, step out of the building, that is, be sure to come find me or one of the volunteers. They all have badges, and we want to get you a hand stamp, because when you come back in, we're going to ask for that. If you don't have it, then we're not going to let you in. I mean, the Freight is such a popular place. Everyone's trying to get in here, and tonight's show is sold out. So be sure to get a hand stamp if you have not already. Tonight we have two acts and an intermission. After the first act, about 15 minutes, if you go outside, another way to, or into the lobby, another way to support the Freight is to pick up a t-shirt or a baseball cap. We've got a new logo, and so if you haven't seen it yet, check it out. And we also encourage you to support our artists as well. They've got CDs and things out there too, so please be sure to pick up that. All right. So, our first act is a Nashville-based producer, writer, and performer whose signature sonic style resonates in all he creates, from cinematic pop soundscapes to electronic-tinged theater scores to his honest, direct songwriting. Please join me in welcoming to the Freight stage, Alex Wong.
Hold on, it's so much warmer up here than it is backstage. I just need to sit for a second. My fingers are moving. This is good. I look forward to this so much. Thank you guys so much for being here. My name is Alex Wong. I'm very grateful to come back and play and open up for my great friend Vienna Teng. And yeah, did you guys have a good year? Good. Sounded like a real, real winner. Well, I had a good year, and I'm very grateful to be here and get to kind of mark time with these shows. And this is a song I'd like to start with that was inspired by a friend of mine who told me that there were only 20 kinds of faces in the whole world. And that everyone's face is kind of this variation off these 20 main face shapes. And speaking of time, I love that story, and I thought about it as I kind of went through life. And I always wanted there to be kind of this tribe, like my people, that I would find, you know, as you go through life, you kind of recognize them. Maybe you'd see the way their jawline looked really familiar, or the shape of their neck or something, and you'd think, oh man, I know that person. And maybe you get closer and you realize that you don't. Maybe you wave at them and they look at you like you're a psycho or something. But some of them, I think, it's going to be like that. I mean, Shar, if you have anything to add, please. It's going to be one of those shows. I think she was just trying to tell me that I was talking too much and I should probably play this song. Anyway, I'd like to think that there's a tribe of people that we kind of go through life to life with. And sometimes we find them, and sometimes we find them the next time around. So this is for those people. This is called 20 Faces. The world is full of faces that we already know.
like pieces from a puzzle scattered long ago. Yeah, but don't I know you? Have we met before? Yeah, the world is full of faces that we already know. Yeah, the world is full of melodies we've already heard. We sing them in our sleep, we remember the words. Repeat the chorus, change the verse. Yeah, the world is full of melodies we've already heard. Sleep till the sun coats your eyes, till the darkness subsides. Look around, I will see you on the other side. Oh, oh, oh. Yeah, the world is full of places that we've already been. We recognize the rooftops from our flying dreams. And I swear I've walked you down this street. Yeah, the world is full of places that we've already been. Sleep till the sun coats your eyes, till the darkness subsides. Yeah, look around, I will see you on the other side. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh. Full of lovers that we've lost before. We chase them through the ages, through the coldest wars. Yeah, but now I've found you, now I'm sure. You're the one I want, I'm not afraid anymore. You're the
I've got a record coming out early next year. And thank you. And I've started to put out singles from that record, and this is this was the first single. And I just saw this film. I'm just going to meander here. I just saw this film called Chinatown Rising. It's a documentary. If you guys get a chance to see it, you should definitely see it. It's about kind of the experience of being a Chinese American in this area, in Chinatown in the 60s. And it was really inspiring to me because I've been trying to articulate something for a while that I've been working out through my songs that I think this film really touched on for me. And for me, it was sort of contending with this lesson that I'd learned over growing up here in this area, being a second generation Chinese American, which was kind of to hide and to kind of keep my head down, stay small, don't make waves. And these things are, you know, they're obviously there to keep you safe, and they're not necessarily the wrong lesson, but I think at some point you gotta learn how to, like, take up your own space and kind of claim it for yourself. And that process was a long one for me. So this song was kind of inspired by my experience dealing with that. It's called Show Yourself. Close my eyes and I count to 10. You vanished just like you did back then, beneath the branches of the banyan tree. Oh, why do you still hide from me? The sun is low in the southern sky, our shadows stretch into the night. Close my eyes and I count to 10. Do we have to play this game again? Show yourself, show yourself. Well, come out, wherever you are. Show yourself. Well, come out, wherever you are. Wherever you are, the monsters we keep out of sight still scratch at the door, go bump in the night. But wild things will not be tamed until we call them out by name. I miss the sound of my father's Chinese fading in the suburban breeze. Why do I run from what I used to be? Why am I hiding from my history? Show yourself, come out, wherever you are. Show yourself, come out, wherever you are, wherever you are, wherever you are. Come out, wherever you are.
Show yourself, show yourself. Come out, come out, wherever you are, wherever you are, wherever you are, wherever you are, wherever you are.
Thank you so much. So, climate change. Always a great segue. I find that when I write, I'm always, I write because I have a question about something. It's kind of the only way that I get motivated to write a song is to try to figure it out, something I can't figure out otherwise in real life. So I kind of have to work it out in song life. And I wrote a record and released a record this year with a good friend of mine named Jesse Terry, who's a great songwriter. If you guys get a chance, please check him out. And we got together to write one day, and we didn't know what we were writing, what we were going to write about. And I had been reading this article about this town in Alaska called Kivalina. And the reason the article was written was because it was it had the dubious distinction of being one of the first North American towns to go underwater. At the time, it was going to be 10 years, so this town was going to go underwater in 10 years. And I was like, I was going down this rabbit hole. I feel bad for Jesse showing up, and I was kind of like reading these articles about this place and the situation there. And so that's all I could talk about during our session. But he luckily got interested too, and we ended up reading a lot about this place and other places kind of in the same predicament. And we ended up writing an album basically about this town. And it's a little hard to, you know, it's a little bit of a buzzkill. And it's also like kind of hard as a songwriter because, you know, you're not sitting here trying to, we're not experts. We're trying to figure out what our way in is. And we figured out that it just, the story was so relatable to me living, you know, growing up here and having family that lives on the coast. And it wasn't kind of like the images of like icebergs falling, you know, glaciers cleaving into the ocean or polar bears floating on icebergs that really got to me. It was like these really mundane questions that these people were asking, like if the cemetery where my grandparents are buried goes underwater, what happens to them? Or if the land that I kind of identify with is gone, does that change my identity as a person? And this was all stuff that I felt really, it really resonated with me. So we found that our way into it was to write a breakup album about this fictitious couple that lives there with the sort of backdrop of these decisions that they would have to make because of climate change. So now that I've totally sold you on that, here's an upbeat, poppy number about climate change.
Born into an innocent life, far away from the stations that crackle at night. Look around, our shelter is gone. Yeah, the ice is too thin to wander upon. Yeah, the ice is too thin to wander upon. And no one argues. These are dangerous times, dangerous times. Grab hold of me, grab hold of me. These are dangerous times, dangerous times. I never thought I'd live to see. Yeah, well, maybe it's true, we don't matter at all. Shouldn't be so hard to move something so small. We made this our home, 'cause they put us here. Yeah, where will they be when it all disappears? Yeah, where will they be when it all disappears? And no one argues. These are dangerous times, grab hold of me, grab hold of me. These are dangerous times, dangerous times. I never thought I'd live to see. These are dangerous times, grab hold of me, grab hold of me. These are dangerous times, I never thought I'd live to see. Oh, 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 I never thought I'd live to see. Oh, 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 such a fine place to build a town. Where are we now? Where are we now? Where are we now? These are dangerous times, grab hold of me, grab hold of me. These are dangerous times, I never thought I'd live to see. These are dangerous times, grab hold of me, grab hold of me. These are dangerous times, I never thought I'd live to see. Oh, 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 I never thought I'd live to see. Oh, 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 oh. We were born into an innocent life.
Thank you, guys. Is anyone here last year? Thanks for coming back. Last year, I had just started a song, and I played kind of a half song, and I always felt a little guilt about that, and so if I was going to do one thing last year, it was finish that goddamn song and come back and play it for you. This is a song that comes from a musical that I have been writing with a couple other friends of mine, Amber Rubarth and Devin Copley. And we actually got to do our very first production of this musical this last year, about a block away from here at the Osher Theater, thanks to a really great Bay Area theater company called Play Cafe, or Musical Cafe. And it was an awesome and totally stressful experience. Musicals are hard. But it was really transformative, and it just made us so excited about the next step for this show. So I want to play you guys this song from the show, and I would love to invite a friend of mine out here, Megan Slankard, another amazing local artist. Megan and I have gotten to work on a lot of music together. We've just made 2 records this year, which are coming out next year. So stay tuned. Remember this face. So this song is kind of the... it's an important scene, I hope, in the show. It's funny being home because you tend to think, you know, all this stuff comes up about family and kind of what that all means. And in this show, there's sort of a difficult relationship with a father and a daughter. And the father doesn't get a chance to tell the daughter a lot of things when he was alive. And so it's our own musical, so he's a ghost and he comes back. So this is a ghost dad singing to his daughter about stuff that he wished he could tell her when he was alive. And he's a scientist, so he's not the most, he speaks very science-y. Every action has a reaction. Every effect has a cause. We all learn the laws in school. But an open defiance of logic and science, we like to pretend alone we can bend the rules. Every precious painting is only reflected light. Our favorite song, just waves of sound. And all of our ancient stories would never be found across the night above, if not for love. Our recollections are only reflections of colors and sounds dancing around our brain. Memories make us, they build and they break us. And though the moment won't last, the glow of the past remains. And every birthday candle is circled around the sun. Every gift just bows and string, but we'd never close our eyes and wish for the thing that we are dreaming of, if not for love. Time equals distance divided by speed, and the clock spins around, but we're not guaranteed that if something was here, it will be here again when we finally look up from the space that we're in. Celestial bodies are drifting away before we could say what we needed to say. Not for love. If not for love. If not for love. If not for love. Thanks, you guys. You want to sing another one with me?
Can I just say, I saw the musical, the preview, and when it comes out, you are going to flip for this. You must all line up. You must buy tickets immediately. I know it's not out yet, but.
This is a totally unbiased, objective review right there.
It made me cry.
So here's an old song, but it's finally coming out on my new record. And I also wrote this one with Amber Rubarth. It's called In the Creases. You're the smell of the toast you made in the morning. You're the page in my book I keep to myself. You're the unlocking sound when I turn my door keys. You're the scar that I have from the time that I fell. And I can't describe the faces, I can't recall the names, but you remain. I keep you in the creases, I hide you in the folds, protect you from the sunlight, shield you from the cold. And everybody said they were glad to see you go, but no one ever has to know. You're the part of the moon that fades into blackness. Even though we know it's really still there. You're the song that I sing and I don't need to practice. You're the green shirt I keep though it's too small to wear. And I can't describe the faces, I can't recall the names, but you remain. I keep you in the creases, I hide you in the folds, protect you from the sunlight, shield you from the cold. Everybody said they were glad to see you go, but no one ever has to. No one ever has to know the things that I refuse to see, and all the nights I still can't sleep, I curl between the sheets. The creases where you used to be. I hide you in the folds, protect you from the sunlight, shield you from the
keep you in the creases. I hide you in the folds, protect you from the sunlight, shield you from the cold.
Thank you. Thank you so much for listening. You can get that song tonight. I've got my new record. It doesn't come out till February 21st, but I have them here tonight. So if you're interested, come see me. I'll be out in the lobby after the set. And I just want to do one more song. I basically talked my way out of another song. So I'm going to invite another friend of mine onto the stage. You might know her, Vienna Teng. I didn't actually mean to end my set with my three slowest songs, but that's what you got. But I wanted to play this one for a number of reasons. Which you will see in a second. This song comes from my new record as well. Vienna is actually featured on the song, and it was inspired by a friend of mine who had a baby. Different friend. But I hadn't had a lot of experience with baby interaction of friends at that point, and I was a little nervous to go visit the baby. And I went over there, and it'll be fine with your baby, don't worry. And I was holding the baby very gingerly and trying to remember to say all the things I was supposed to say, like, it's the most beautiful baby I've ever seen, and it looks exactly like the mother and the father. And all I was thinking about in my head was how much it looked like an alien. So I wrote a lullaby about an alien baby, and here it is. This is called Maybe When You're Older.
Show me what you've seen. What did you discover? On the other side, before we met each other, every time you see the stars, you'll remember what you are. Don't you cry, my dear, the plan is set in motion. Gather all your tears, drop them in the ocean. Always.
Oh, I screwed that up. Hold on. Three.
Every time you
screwed it up twice.
Always staring at the sky. Now I know the reason why. Ooh. Thank you. sleep, my love, before the night grows colder, and I will ask you more. Maybe when you're older.
Thank you guys so much for listening. Vienna Teng, everybody. Megan Slankard. My name is Alex Wong, and I'll be in the lobby. I'd love to talk to you. Thanks so much.
I think somebody's messing with us. Okay, this thing is on. Hi, I am not Sri Devi. I am Bob. I am the production manager here, and I brought a few notes with me, so you know it shouldn't take any more than 10 or 15 minutes. First of all, another big hand for Alex Wong. Great set. And I got a couple of shout outs for a couple of people. Two are here tonight, one is virtually here. First of all, I want to say hi to Suzanne Fox in the back there. Longtime night manager at the Freight and Salvage. And then somewhere down here is a lady named Trish. It's her birthday today, so happy birthday, Trish. I know, you're gonna get back to me for that, right? Yeah, okay. And we're webcasting the show tonight. There's Michelle and Eric up there taking care of that. Greg over there. So we're breaking out beyond these walls, and we're all over the place. And because we're doing that tonight, I am able to say, hello, Jacob, we miss you. Then I had a bunch of other notes, but I left them back there, so I won't do that. What I did want to say was that Vienna's been doing these holiday shows here at the Freight, I believe, since 2011 or 2012. It's been a while. But it really does feel much like a holiday because there's so many familiar faces here every year for every show. And it's kind of like a big family gathering. And it's outside of, you know, my family, your family. We're one big musical family. And the reason we are a family is because of the next person who's coming on stage. And that is why I'm asking you to please welcome Vienna Teng.
What is going to happen tonight? I don't know. I don't know what the first song is. Oh, wow, okay. We'll get to that one. Let's start with that one. What about this one? Oh, all right. So, yeah, it is nice in the age of technology and dear tech-savvy friends like Michelle and Eric that we can live stream a show like this all around the world, and especially to my husband in DC, who is in the middle of unpacking things from a road trip in which he packed stuff from his mom's house so that we can have them in our house. So that's why he's not here this evening, but it's fun to have, to know he's here watching in his own way. And so this is a song that I guess was inspired by him and lots of other stuff, including science.
Detect my sudden existence on your sonar. You feel the echo. Electrify the resistance in your broken heart and burn it up, oh, oh. We're gonna photosynthesize and drink up the sunrise, oh, 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 oh. So do they ever shut up because you said so, or do you overthink them all? Somebody ought to corrupt you on the dance floor and take you home and show you all your demons and desires and dark sides. Oh, 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 oh. All of your colonies and continental divides. Oh, 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 oh. dark hair, the weight of your bones. I want to witness the beauty of your repair, the shape you've grown. For you are made of nebulas and novas and night sky. Oh, 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 you're made of memories you bury or live by. Oh, 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 so if you're out there in the cold, I'll cover you in moonlight. If you're a stranger to your soul, I'll bring you to your birthright. Now I want your warm, bright eyes to never look away, look away, look away. Don't you ever look away, look away, look away. Don't you ever look away, look away, look away. Don't you ever look away, look away. Some nights we open up the flood, and some nights we're lost, and some nights we're choking on. Some we light on fire. If you're out there in the cold, I'll cover you in moonlight. If you're a stranger to your soul, I'll bring it to your birthright. I want the storm inside you awoken now. I want your warm, bright eyes to come back to me and hold on to me. You know that I want the light. Don't you ever look away, look away, look away. Don't you ever look away, look away.
Oh, all right. It's an interesting second song to do. When I do this song solo and without a couple of other additional accoutrements, I do basically the sort of unplugged version of a song that normally involves robotic noises. And it was in fact written that way. I had gotten this machine, which basically allows me to, when hooked up with an electronic keyboard, allows me to basically create duplicates of myself, which I sometimes call the Imogen Heap button or the Vienna Girls Choir button. So I had a lot of fun with it when I first got it, and felt like I should write something with this sort of new instrument, basically. And what came to mind was creepy chorales sung by robots. Was the sort of songwriting prompt I gave myself. The way I did it was by taking this one melody that I'd started to play around with, but frankly found a little boring. I'm like, oh, that's a little kind of, you know, typical. It's like this sort of like soothing little melody, I guess. And as I started developing it with this theme and using this instrument of, you know, electronic multiplication, it kind of took on a life of its own. And so now when I do play it acoustically in the quote unquote boring way, to me it sounds extra creepy. It's what animators sometimes call the uncanny valley, you know, when it's a little too realistic. You're like, ah, oh, that's no good. Like cats, maybe.
Somebody hears you, you know that. You know that somebody hears you, you know that inside. Someone is learning the colors of all your moods. your life open. You don't have to leave your life open. You don't have to hide. Someone is gathering every crumb you drop. These moments you
My sheepish confession is that after writing that song about Axiom and the other companies that basically spy on all our online movements and market things to us, I still don't always read the terms and conditions. And I don't necessarily use like secure browsing or anything. And they're like, oh, do you want to stay logged in? It's just easier. I'm like, yeah, maybe. I like when they're not song titles and they're just sort of open-ended prompts like a song to sing along to. We will definitely get to that, and we will get to that, and we will get to this one. Oh, yes. So, as Alex referred to, there's some life changes that are happening. Before, a couple of shows I did earlier this month, I just kind of walked out without any kind of announcement, you know, no like opening act beforehand. And I just like, you know, Ali Wong style, just didn't acknowledge it for the first several songs. And then I, you know, tried to say something snarky like, so, you know, after a lot of deciding and trying to figure out if I really wanted to do it, I decided I'm going to grow my hair out, you know, like. But now the cat is out of the bag, as it were. So I've been thinking a lot lately about like how many songs I've actually written like directed to or about small children in the course of my life, even though I remain very ambivalent about maybe having a kid of my own for a long time. And one of the things that strikes me, to be honest, is how idealized all of my kid songs are. is really nothing about like, oh, please, I just clean that up, or like, I am really gonna tell you that for the 14th time, I guess, but that's just gonna be how this goes. So this one is was actually written for someone who's in the audience tonight. This is a song that I wrote when I was 17 that was kind of directed to my little sister, who is not so little anymore. But it's a fun kind of song that connects us both, and it's called Lullaby for a Stormy Night.
Child, be not afraid. The rain pounds harshly against the glass like an unwanted stranger. There is no danger. I am here tonight. Little child, be not afraid. The thunder explodes and lightning flash illuminates your tear-stained face. I am here tonight, and someday you'll know the nature so. The same rain that draws you near me falls on rivers and land, on forest and sand, makes the beautiful world that you'll see in the morning. Little child, be not afraid. The storm clouds mask your beloved moon, and its candlelight beams still keep pleasant dreams. I am here tonight. Little child, be not afraid. The wind makes creatures of our trees, and their branches to hands they're not real understand. And I am here tonight, and someday you'll know the nature so. The same rain that draws you near me falls on rivers and land, on forest and sand, makes the beautiful world that you see in the morning. For you know, once even I was a little child, and I was afraid. But a gentle someone always came to dry all my tears, treat sweet sleep for fears, and to give a kiss goodnight. Well, now I'm grown, and these years have shone the rain's a part of how life goes. But it's dark and it's late, so I'll hold you and wait till your frightened eyes do close. And I hope that you'll know your soul. The same rain that draws you near me falls on rivers and land, on forests and sand, makes the beautiful world that you see in the morning. Everything's fine in the morning. The rain will be gone in the morning, but I'll still be here in the morning.
Continuing on the lullaby trip for a bit, and then I will get off of it so that you don't all fall asleep. This is a holiday song, a little, several days late, but I decided I would try to learn, one of those older Christmas carols for the shows I was doing this month, and had always loved this one that I got to sing in choir and then like kind of heard it on recordings since, called Coventry Carol. Do any of you know it? And then, as I was kind of learning it, or at least, some miniature version of it to do live, I decided to, you know, look it up on Wikipedia and read about the history of it, and it is a dark song. So I'm not going to sing all the verses, but basically, it's not, you know, a song of, you know, like, you know, the Virgin Mary singing to baby Jesus or anything like that. It's actually mothers singing to their children before they're to be slaughtered. It was part of, you know, this whole story of King Herod and how he ordered all these children to be put to death, and so it's kind of the lullaby before that happens. I'm like, wow, how did that become a well-loved Christmas carol? But it reminds me, it was actually a good reminder that music is weird that way, right? Music gets used to kind of commemorate or to document or to kind of grapple with things that are sort of impossible, and sometimes get, yeah, transformed or transmuted into these things that then get passed on and kind of take on a life of their own. And so in the spirit of that, I figured I'd do this one and then a song that sort of feels a little related. So this is Coventry Carol.
Father says, head down, we don't want them finding you. Mother says, practice now all the words you know. Arizona's burning, they say the fence turned. And now the razor wire keeps us out. Mother says with luck we'll sleep under a roof tonight. Father says in the truck we'll be crushed in tight. Oh, Chicago, don't forget me as the miles between us grow. The maple tree carved with the name of my love. The hills we would sled race down. Lake Michigan, stay endless and painted in sky. Goodbye. Mother says years ago the whole world was ours to rule. Father says, let it go, those days are gone for good. All the signs are read, no gringos, but somehow we'll find our way. Maybe waiting at dawn by the factory doors, sunburns and bends in the fields. Don't turn us in, we'll be silent as the grave. It's time. No gringo, no gringo aquí. Words as levees against the flood. Oy, Serrano, there's too many to feed. Room for only our own kind, our own blood. No gringo, no gringo aquí. You've stayed in this land for too long, Don Amargo. But there's no time to grieve. You just pack up your things and move on. And
interesting. This is a song that I normally do as a duet, and normally do as a duet with Jacob when he's here. But in lieu of that, I think I'll just sing really low when it comes to that part. This one is called Land Sailor. And I will, I'm going to tell the story and then I have to remember the actual words to the song. But one of my favorite things is hearing about people who have introduced my music to small children, who then demand to hear them on repeat, but think the lyrics are different from when I wrote them. And there was someone who tweeted that their 4-year-old who listens to Land Sailor a lot, and then oh, is that you? That's amazing. So I'm not gonna sing, woohoo! So this lyric writer here had the brilliant stroke that the second line of the song should be "Cowmaker, pay your fines," which is really a better lyric when you think about it. So if you want to substitute that in your mind, feel free.
Land sailor, sail on time. Rain or shine, I know you can. Cloud breaker, share your fines. All your wonders at my demand. Light bringer, tamer of night, blossom of hours unleashed. Make me a lawbender, all equalized, safe from the chill and heat. Your power flows through me, transformed. Here's where I was born. Land sailor, deep winter strawberry, endless summer, ever spring. A vast preserve, isle after isle in reach, every commoner made a king. Earthbreaker, noble and prized, feed me beyond my means. Hello, world maker, never denied, build all my wildest dreams. But there's a storm outside your door, and I'm a child no and faceless, tireless and seamless behind these walls. This is my progress when you don't notice my lines at all. I split the world open, delve ever deeper in my alchemic art. I crack the ciphers to free up your mind, your life, your heart. Ooh, ooh. I'm your land sailor in the bed we've made. May every nail be shown. Great life bringer, the price that we pay. It's time that you made it known. I want to be your bride. My eyes no more. Oh, I'm altered now for good. Shield these eyes no
I have a hilarious confession to make. I was so happily distracted by that, that I just played that in the wrong key. I started singing, I'm like, wow, it seems higher than usual. And then I hit this one part where my left hand normally does something, and I'm like, my left hand is like, that is not how we normally do it. But I guess that's how we're doing it right now. We do a looper song for a minute here, just for the fun of it. Mm-hmm.
This is a song inspired by the movie Office Space.
You can see he knows every loophole, the art of fine print, massages the numbers to the fit, and every time you ask him for another vanishing act, he half smiles as if to say, whatever you want, whatever you want, whatever you want is fine by me. Oh, oh, whatever you want, whatever you want, whatever you want is fine by me. Never a real moment together, but she understands you're an important man. Another late night, don't know if you're coming home or when she's alone again. But she goes on curating your domestic museum. She disappears in her loyalty. She is a dress wearing a face in the doorway, opening her arms out to you. Whatever you want, whatever you want, whatever you want is fine by me. Oh, whatever you want, whatever you want, whatever you want is fine by me. Question you, oh no, and no one would dare to stand up. But in the night she leaves the papers in a tidy pile, evidence for her reasons. And in the night he takes the main accounts and pulls the files, detailing every treason. I am the last one you'd ever suspect of setting the fire, of setting the fire. But as you switch on your TV tomorrow morning, you'll hear me saying quietly, whatever you want, whatever you want, whatever you want is fine by me. Whatever you want, whatever you want, whatever you want is fine by me.
That one should be dedicated this season, I think, to people in Foreign Service and the State Department. I was asked to play the song for, it was a request for by someone for someone that they're here with. And I also drew out this other slip of paper that conveniently says, song by Paul Simon. So this is one from their album called Bridge Over Troubled Water. That's the title, title track. Maybe without, you know, violating people's privacy too much, I think the dedication is from a daughter to a father in the audience tonight who drove up from L.A. Daughter's having a bit of a rough patch at the moment, wasn't sure if she'd be able to make it, certainly not traveling on her own, and so her dad drove up in the rain with her to come to these two shows, and it means a lot that they're both here. And so this is for Karen and her dad tonight, called Bridge Over Troubled Water.
When you're weary and feeling small, and when tears are
see how
chasing some mirage in my movie sun. Don't say every chance is lost. Please don't say anything at all. Sand and thorns, I'm walking forth, bare and blinking as the day that I was born. Bells and spires of China white ring for an Augustine tonight.
Continue with the bombast section. Great. I think I picked up a slip of paper earlier this fulfills as well, and someone who's a geeky music nerd person like me who says, anything in mixed meter, please.
Guide you home. All I want there's your horizon to chase. So go far beyond where we stand. No matter the distance,
since it's wonderful to have a chance to play with Alex Wong and to kind of be in the same venue, in the same town together, I thought we ought to play two songs that he and I wrote together. And so this first one is called Antebellum, which I've been playing around with the piano part for a long time and kind of gotten stuck and didn't have melody and didn't have an idea of what it was supposed to be. And I distinctly remember Alex coming over one afternoon and kind of listening to it. And then I remember he sat kind of just on this piano bench next to me and just kind of, when I got to the part that I hadn't written yet, he just would tell me what to play. He's like, go to that chord. I'm like, that chord, okay. And then he's like, and then that chord. I'm like, oh, look, it's a song happening. That's exciting. And then we struggled through other types of, you know, revisions and writer's block together. At one point, this song was about migrating birds. And I think I still remember some lyrics from that version. I'm trying to remember if I can call them up. All through the years and miles of separation, I have held on to the thought of you. We choose the winter or the great migration. And then something, something, something. And so we thought that was kind of cool, and then we realized that neither of us really know that much about birds or what it could be a metaphor for. Or maybe I got really excited and he wasn't, or vice versa. And then we ended up more on the idea of coming back to the fact that, like, there's always, the hands move apart on the piano a lot during this song. And it, the idea of a sort of chosen estrangement kind of came to mind. And so this is a song called Antebellum.
Circle through the leaves and talk about the little ones. And we smile but never say too much, the moment always vanishing. One by one the neighbors' lights come on, our October day is almost. We drew between us, keep the weapons down, keep the wounded safe. I know our antebellum innocence was never meant to see the light of our armistice day. In spring, we climbed the rolling hills and talked about our budding plans. And we smiled our faces like a mirror, showing us our secret sides. But then the fight, the sharp words splintering the night, how I couldn't be what you'd need, but oh, how I could make you bleed. I know the border lines were drew between us. Keep the weapons down, keep the wounded safe. I know our antebellum innocence was never meant to see of our armistice, but how much would I give to have it back again? How much did we lose to live in this
Alex.
Do you have any particular memories of writing that one?
Yeah, I remember what you talked about sitting around your piano in your apartment in Brooklyn and kind of like real time feeling out the chords and realizing, oh, there is a thing here. There's always a point, I think, you just sort of like blindly cast around until you realize that there's actually enough raw material to make a song. That's always a good point. Sometimes you just cast around.
Some days you're like, well, we cast a lot of lines. Just take our fishing hat and go home and come back tomorrow. So here's another song that we wrote together, and actually Alex deserves a credit for this because he said, we're doing a show together, we should just write a new song. I said, you can just do that? I don't write songs that easily. But we were playing around with the idea of drones and kind of having like tones that kind of extend through a whole song.
And in this case, it was really good that we had a deadline because we just put together the song very, very quickly. And actually, I still remember we were playing at the Bell House in Brooklyn, and we were debuting the song for the first time, and Alex was still frantically writing lyrics backstage. And at the time, we were trying to do it with wine glasses that were pitched a certain way, and I was trying to practice how to do that. And we got out on stage, and the song took about 5 minutes to get going because I was so nervous that I couldn't do the wine glass. And I was just like, it's not working.
It's like me with whistling. I tried to do a whistle song once, but I was too nervous, so just blowing air.
Well, this song will fulfill a slip of paper from earlier of things that involve all of us singing together. So we'll look meaningfully at you when that part happens. This is called The Breaking Light.
Watch the shadow lines fade away. Brother, you will return. Let your lion heart cleave the waves, brother, you will return. In the breaking light. Listen to the colors, carry them inside you, they will bring you back to me.
Listen to the sirens, listen to the heartbeat, listen to the turning tide. Listen to the murmurs, carry them inside you till we're on the other side. In the breaking light. In the breaking light. Ooh.
Alex Wong, everyone. Thank you, Alex. Why don't we continue in the sing-along part, yeah? Some of you want to come up here and form a little choir for Soon Love Soon? Any of you want to do that? Thank you for the first few brave people who are like, come on, we're doing this, right? So for those of you who don't know how this song goes, there are two parts that I would love for you to sing along to. First part goes like this.
Soon, love, soon, ooh. Soon, love, soon.
So, if any of you are feeling harmonically inclined, you could also do
soon, love, soon, ooh. Soon, love, soon, ooh.
Or
soon, love, soon.
Try whatever part you want of those three.
Soon, love, soon, soon, love, soon, soon, love, soon.
Three, four.
Soon, love, soon. Soon, love, soon.
Oh, that's exciting. All right, part two goes like this.
And we will be as one God, and we will be as one people, and we will be as one God, and we will be as one people.
Oh, we have some clever harmonizers in that one too. That's very exciting. All right. So, that's basically the whole song. I say some things in the middle. So here we go.
Soon, love, soon, there'll be a fire burning in the temple of our peace. There'll be a soaring voice for a silent plea. We will hold a broken circle and begin to pray. We will find a black and white in the gray. And we will be as one God. And we will be as one. natural light. You will travel 1,000 miles without leaving my sight. We'll find we never knew hatred ran so deep. Such a wide, wide chasm of faith to leap, and we will be as one God,
and we will be as one people, and we will be as one God, and we will be as one people. Soon,
there will be an evolution of the human soul.
Soon,
we will know that to be a part is to be truly whole.
Soon,
we will know the pattern of centuries rise and fall.
Soon,
we will know that the fate of one is the fate of all. And we will be as one God,
and we will be as one people, and we will be as one God, and we will be as one people, and we will be as one God.
Great big round of applause for the Freight and Salvage Choir, everybody. This is all kind of improvised, but I figure since you're up here, you can also be the stomp clapping section.
Yeah.
Okay, great. You guys can do this too. This is called Grandmother Song. And here we go. I hope I'm not freaking out the Freight and Salvage. Like, we have not seen this many feet stamping on this stage. Hopefully it is built for that. Now don't speed up because it makes it harder for me. Oh girl, you think you got time? Gonna get round to it way down the line. But one step, two step, you fall behind. And so you better have a good plan. Oh girl, you think you got time? Gonna get round to it way down the line. But I'm telling you, no matter what you have in mind, you're still gonna need a man. Take it from your grandmother, I've been round, I've been round, I've been round. Yeah, take it from your grandmother, I've been round, I've been round, I've been round. No, no one's gonna take care of you in that world that you got yourself into. All the good boys, honey, they're in grad school. Oh girl, your story's all wrong. You dream of being a nightmare before too long. You're turning 30 and still trying to sing your songs. So come on, who do you think you are? Oh girl, it's too heavy a load. Your mama and your baba, they are worried souls. How you gonna raise a family when you're on the road with some tattooed boy with a guitar? Take it from your grandmother, I've been round, I've been round, I've been round. Yeah, take it from your grandmother, I've been round, I've been round, I've been round. No, this music career isn't real life. It won't see you through to when you're 65. And when the tide turns, you won't survive. Sit on the banks and cry, cry. Baby's gonna cry, oh baby's gonna cry. Oh girl, you never know war when they come in the night and they knock on the door. And you can go from the high life to dirty poor, lose everything you knew. But the one thing they can't take away from you is your mind and the education you've been through. And so you find a man who understands that too. Yeah.
And make sure that he stays true, gives respect where it's due. Make sure he knows, make sure he knows, make sure he knows what he's got in you. Because a woman isn't just for cooking meals, scrubbing floors, making babies. A woman's got ambition, same as he does, maybe more. When the sirens wailed and the bombs fell, we ran from the schoolyard into hell. And what we could have been, time will never tell, because we never had your chances, the advantages that you have been handed. Girl, you'll never know how hard it was, so you've got to do this for all of us. Take it from your grandmother, I've been round, I've been round, I've been round. Yeah, take it from your grandmother, I've been round, I've been round, I've been round. Yeah, take it from your grandmother, I've been round, I've been round, I've been round. Yeah, take it from your grandmother, I've been round. Thank you all so much. You've been wonderful. Thank you. Thought I'd do a few more songs, if that's all right with you. That one was a hard finale to follow, though. Thank you again for coming up on stage and singing so beautifully, clapping so beautifully. This is another request that was put in the bucket that I did draw out. I figured I'd do kind of later. So this is a Chinese lullaby, and it has a couple of different connotations for me at this point. That's the fun thing about songs that kind of stay with you through different chapters of life. And so it first began as a lullaby that my parents would sing to me and my siblings when we were very young. And I heard the words wrong as a kid, and I thought that my lyrics were better. Because there's a part where, at least in the original versions and the way that my parents sang it, there's a part where you go, yeah, just for the Changyin. And they always like emphasized it. And the tones in Chinese, you know, kind of change the meanings of words. And so Changying means long shadows, and Changying means flies. And so I always thought the lyric was, even the palm tree's flies can't hide how I feel for you. And there was another phrase that, like, it was actually supposed to be like, you know, ever flowing towards you and increasing. And I thought it was, it doesn't matter whether you're listening or not. Was, or I think it doesn't matter if you're thinking clearly, I think was what I thought it was. I'm like, that's an interesting lyric. And so I also have fond memories of deciding to record this for my second album, Warm Strangers. And I mentioned this to my mother, and she kind of got that very motherly, worried look. And she said, let's work on your pronunciation then, shall we? So she coached me through it and, you know, kind of got to the point where it sounded like, you know, not terribly like a you know, dumb American speaking Chinese. And I remember I was in the recording studio in Nashville, no Chinese speakers around. Producer had a wonderful southern twang. And so we decided that maybe what I should do is I should stand in the recording booth and I'd call my mom, and I would just talk to her in Chinese for like a few minutes, and then hang up and just record the song without switching back. So that's another memory I have. And most recently, my husband Jacob has two wonderful kids, one of whom is in the audience tonight, traveling with me out here to California. And she spent a year abroad in Taiwan, and actually one of her Taiwan exchange friends is with her too, which is pretty fun that they get to meet up here.
And she apparently sang the song in a talent show when she was over there on the exchange program and won people over with the fact that she could sing a song. And she's like, well, I kind of cheated because I've heard you sing it around the house. And so, you know. So it's wonderful to have all these different kind of stories of family and language and adventures kind of woven into it. So with that very long introduction, this is called 绿道小乐曲.
这绿道像一只船，在月夜里摇呀摇，姑娘呀，你也在我的心海里。 吹开了你的窗帘，让我的钟心随那流水不断地向你倾诉。椰子树的长影掩不住我的情意。
This is one that I don't play very often, but it was requested by someone who's very special. She is watching, I think, on the live stream, or she may have gone to sleep and decided to watch this later, because it's late where she is. She's taking care of a wonderful and very special young girl named Anna, and has gone through lots and ups and downs, lots of hardships, and have always stuck together. And done everything she can for this kid, and so it's been fun to like kind of watch their journey and to watch Anna grow and become more confident in herself through all these medical procedures and things that she has to go through, and all of the strength that she draws from my friend Angie is pretty inspiring to see. So Angie requested that I play the song from my first album called Daughter.
Well, it's you and it's me, me with a drink in my hand. The ice is tinkling like a wind chime. A late afternoon settles over the land, and you're talking about things interesting just lately, and things that matter too much to say anyway but lightly. Did you know you're so beautiful on the edge of summer? The years from now I'll cry to remember how very close you were. Knowing this, will I reach for you? Knowing this, will I reach for you the way you want me to? It's time to be wise, wise in the ways of the heart, to come out from under the covers, this voluntary state of apart from the faces, oasis in the Sahara of sorrow, these graces that hold me. It's from you that I borrow. Did you know you're so beautiful on the edge of summer? Years from now I'll cry to remember how very close you were. Knowing this, will I reach for you? Knowing this, will I reach for you the way you want me to?
Thank you so, so much for your beautiful attention and giving of energy tonight and coming out on a school night. So I wanted to leave you, this is, I guess, very poor form in some ways, like, you know, I should end with a thing that everyone knows and, you know, loves and you can clap along to, but I'm not. I'm going to play another request that came from someone special, so I haven't played this song in quite a long time. And I was fooling around with it on during soundcheck, and we'll try something a little different with it. And I wanted to end with this one in part because it's a song that I wrote about a moment of kind of uncertainty in the greater world. And, you know, it's the story of kind of two people who are just sort of trying to find out, like, what am I supposed to do right now? I'm kind of swept up in this period of tumult and uncertainty and possibility, but also danger. And I kind of feel like we're in that moment right now a little bit. And I certainly have spent a lot of time thinking, like, what am I supposed to do in this moment? And maybe if I can leave you with that without any answers per se, but maybe a question going into the new year. This is called St. Stephen's Cross.
Bound yon virgin mother.
the wall came down. He lost her in the endless crowd. In the shadow of St. Stephen's cross, sent cries aloft for his fellow man, his fingers slipping from her hand, and the rain clouds prowling breathing.